Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents What Really Matters: How to Care for Yourself and Serve a Hurting World by Hal Donaldson with Lindsay Donaldson Kring. Foreword by Lisa Harper. Narrated by Brandon Pollock. Foreword. A few years ago, one of my professors in the DeMin program at Denver Seminary, Dr. Brad Strait, effectively nailed me to my chair with this simple observation. Jesus' earthly ministry happened at the pace of approximately 3 miles per hour, because he walked everywhere he went. In all my years of study and poring over the Bible, I'd never once thought about the pace of our Messiah's praxis. How he never missed a God moment, well, because he is God, but besides that massive theological given, Jesus did life in the unforced rhythm of grace. He lived unhurriedly enough to be extraordinarily interruptible. Lepers were able to ask him for help when he and the disciples ambled past on their way to town. He sat still long enough for children to climb into his lap for a story and a cuddle. He looked deep into lonely people's eyes because he wasn't staring at his phone. I can't help but wonder how many miracles I've hurried past on any given day to finish my to-do list. Frankly, I've spent way too much of my adult life working as if my worth depended on it, as if all the midnight oil I was burning for kingdom purposes was adding up in some sort of divine frequent flyer program. When Hal and Doree graciously invited me to pen the foreword for this wonderful book, I thought they were teasing because self-care is not my strong suit. But I'm very grateful they overlooked that inauspicious detail and allowed me to peruse an advanced copy of What Really Matters, because it's been both a template and a testimony to help me adapt my rhythm to a more sustainable and God-honoring pace. Plus, it's written with such empathy and authenticity that I didn't have to choke down guilt to get the message. In What Really Matters, Hal, whom I deeply respect, so it's a bit awkward for me to address him by his first name without adding a Mr., shares readily applicable principles of Christ-centered self-care against the backdrop of his story and the story of Convoy of Hope, an international faith-based nonprofit that helps millions around the world. But please know this book isn't a PR piece that touts an impressive personal resume or global ministry efficacy. Instead, it's encouraging and relatable because it's about one man's genuine journey with Jesus to try and help the poor and powerless, the missed and the marginalized, while not damaging himself or his relationships in the process. Christ-centered self-care has been discussed a lot in faith communities over the last several years, but often only in the context of specific groups like single parents or those who have recently gone through a divorce or lost a loved one. However, self-care isn't just for image bearers in crisis or limited to those seasons when we feel like we can't carry the weight of our own lives anymore. Instead, it's for all of us, all the time. Furthermore, contrary to what's often modeled and applauded in communities of faith, caring for ourselves is not selfish. In fact, God modeled self-care when he crashed out on a celestial couch after breathing the world into existence, Genesis chapter 2, verses 2 through 3. Plus, he rested before the fall. So self-care isn't an accommodation for human weakness or sin. It's our Creator Redeemer's merciful provision for our protection because he loves us unconditionally and is absolutely for us. Please consider this lovely book and the life-giving hope throughout it as a gift from your Heavenly Father, chosen especially for you. Then take a few deep breaths before continuing and remember the promise Jesus proclaims to those of us whose hearts have been worn thin. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Matthew, chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. Warmest regards, Lisa Harper. Introduction. It should have been one of the most fulfilling days of my life. Instead, my joy was threatened by an avalanche of harsh memories and pent-up emotion. More than 1,000 guests had gathered to celebrate the grand opening of Convoy of Hope's new distribution center. Two governors presented inspiring speeches, business and church leaders offered meaningful testimonials, and a series of compelling videos played. Despite the enthusiastic crowd and festivities, I felt more like an embattled survivor than a CEO. Other than my wife and four daughters, few knew the toll it had taken on me to launch and steward one of the nation's 50 largest charities. That day, I should have been celebrating the 200 million people Convoy of Hope had served and the $2 billion in food and supplies distributed. Instead, alone in my thoughts, I reflected on the hard times, the loneliness, personal attacks, scarcity of resources, misunderstandings, nights away from my family, and lost loved ones. As applause echoed throughout the cavernous distribution center and the audience stood to its feet, I held back tears of joy mingled with regret. My wife and daughters were seated on the front row, and I couldn't help but ponder the price they had paid. In my quest to feed hungry children around the world, serve disaster survivors, and help impoverished families, how many band concerts and soccer games had I missed? When my daughter Erin Ray broke her arm, I was in a remote village in northern Kenya, delivering water to drought-stricken families. When my daughter Lauren scored her first goal, I was in New Orleans responding to Hurricane Katrina. They had every reason to be resentful and rebellious. Even my wife, Doree, could have checked out. After all, many days she was filling the shoes of mother and father. I didn't doubt my family's love for me or their admiration for the work of Convoy of Hope, but had they ever questioned how much I cherished them? They must have felt neglected and, at times, even abandoned. When I was home, I worked hard to make up for lost time. I planned special vacations, took my daughters on daddy dates, told nightly bedtime stories, and hugged them tightly every chance I could. But there's only so much you can do when you're away from home 150 nights a year. I knew I had stretched Doree's limits, my limits, and perhaps God's too. As the grand opening ceremony for the distribution center came to a close, we also broke ground for a new global headquarters and state-of-the-art training center. I had a shovel in my hand when I was summoned backstage to meet with Betty Cribbs. The distribution center had been named after Betty and her late husband, David. They had purchased Convoy of Hope's first tractor trailer and played a significant role in acquiring 230 acres for the new campus in Springfield, Missouri. During some of our most trying days, David and Betty prayed and offered loads of encouragement. And when our car was pushing 150,000 miles, David and Betty gave us their new BMW. That act of generosity came at a time when we needed to know God was with us. We knew they walked close to God and listened to His voice. "Betty," I said, "I only wish David was here with us today." She replied, "I know he's looking down from heaven." "Yes, I believe that," I said with a smile. "Hal, there's something I need to tell you," she said, motioning for me to come closer. The center was still buzzing, so I turned my ear toward Betty and leaned in so I could hear every word. "God wants you to trust him for more," she whispered. "There's much more he wants to do here. You've trusted him for thousands and millions of dollars. Now he wants you to believe him for tens of millions. This is just the beginning." At that moment, the floodgates opened. Tears gushed down my cheeks. Through Betty, God delivered a timely message. I could almost hear him saying, "Hal, I understand where you're at. I know better than anyone the challenges you've faced, but you can stop staring in the rearview mirror. Fix your eyes on the task ahead. There are millions who still need help now and hope for eternity. Yes, at times you've been mistreated and misunderstood, but you don't need to look over your shoulder. The past is the past. I have blessed you and protected you and your family. I am with you." That afternoon, on the drive home from the grand opening, Jesus and I had a celebration. At the top of my lungs, I said, "Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for all you've done." My shirt front was drenched with tears of gratitude. My smile felt like it was touching my ears. I glanced at the speedometer and noticed that, without realizing it, I was driving 92 in a 65-mile-per-hour zone. I pumped the brakes, but my heart was so full of joy I could have walked home. Through all the disappointments and hardships, Jesus still had me in his sights. He was never distracted or disinterested. The enemy of this world wanted me to look back and be crippled by the arduous journey. God wanted me to process the past and focus on the opportunities and miracles just around the corner. Holy pep talks. Everyone needs pep talks. The Bible is filled with examples of people at the end of their rope. Elijah, for example, was so discouraged he wanted to die. "I have had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors." 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 4. On occasion, we all need to be reminded this isn't the end. There is hope. We need a pat on the back that urges us to press on, to persevere in the face of opposition and hardship. No one likes pain and suffering, nor do we enjoy conflict. But sometimes it's difficult to persevere because we haven't learned how to care for ourselves. I hope my story and the lessons I've learned will be a guidebook of sorts for taking care of yourself and staying encouraged while you endeavor to serve a hurting world. God is for you, but perhaps because of adverse circumstances or a myriad of factors, you have doubted His care and concern. You've questioned whether He even knows what you're going through. That's understandable, especially when your world seems to be caving in and you feel alone. You don't need to feel guilty or ashamed for those emotions. Regardless of where you are today, God wants to assure you of His love and attention. He is with you, and He's at work on your behalf. Like He told Joshua, He's saying to you, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." Joshua chapter 1, verse 9. I'm learning that caring for my mental, spiritual, and physical health is a partnership between God and me. He will do His part, but I also need to do mine. Sometimes we wallow in pain because we don't take advantage of the tools God has given us to care for ourselves. Other times we suffer because we make sacrifices He didn't ask us to make. This book will help you to do your part to care for yourself, with a full understanding that we all need God's provision and influence in every aspect of our lives. Yes, the world is broken and in crisis, but Jesus isn't conceding anything. He wants to partner with you to distribute lasting hope to people in need. You weren't created to be a victim. You're an overcomer who has been raised up by Almighty God to bring hope and healing to the world. But if you don't take care of yourself and guard your heart, you are accepting less than what God intends and promises. He doesn't ask you to serve others from a constant deficit. Have you ever tried to help others when you're running on empty and lacking stamina? God wants you to serve others from a place of wholeness. God is infinitely powerful. People are not. Your physical, emotional, and spiritual health affect the well-being of those Jesus has called you to serve. In this way, doing your part to care for yourself is not an act of selfishness, it is a necessary component of selflessness. Self-care can help us build resilience, cope with difficult life events, and improve relationships. But in the past, I largely viewed self-care as optional. Breaking away from a hectic schedule to recharge was a luxury reserved for planned vacations with my wife and daughters. That approach didn't serve me well, and it took me years to realize it. If we don't practice self-care, says Dr. Sam Zand, a clinical psychiatrist, we store unhealthy patterns in our neural pathways. Renewing your mind. The good news is we can change the structure of our neural pathways through what is called neuroplasticity. In short, this describes how our brains change in response to the objects of our attention. So, when scriptures tell us to think on what is true, honorable, pure, lovely, and good, to think on what is excellent and worthy of praise, in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, this is not just a platitude to think happy thoughts, says Dr. Aaron I. Smith, a professor of psychology at California Baptist University. I think that Paul is pointing us to focus on these things because what we pay attention to changes us. Learning about this, I was reminded of Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. God designed us with the ability to change, grow, and become more like Jesus. Regardless of the challenges you face, rest assured Jesus knows how you feel. In the Gospels, we see he experienced persecution, loneliness, betrayal, conflict, weariness, a demanding schedule, and more. But time and again, he broke away from the crowds and obligations to pray, get refreshed, and gain perspective. This book was written to help you prioritize your health and discover ways to remain encouraged. If, at times, you feel the world is against you and the target on your back is the size of a billboard, this book is for you. If you're a leader who is traversing landmines and navigating explosive personalities, this book is for you. If you're new to Jesus and still figuring out what part he plays in your life, this book is for you. Or, if you're retired and have served Jesus for 50 years, this book will provide you with valuable tools. Regardless of our starting point, God is anxious to meet us wherever we are. He's never agitated by our detours and derailments. He simply takes us by the hand, ministers to our needs, and says, "It's time to go. There are hurting people who need our help." Why Scars Remain. When I was 12 years old, God saw my need and came to my rescue. On the way to a business meeting, my parents were hit by a drunk driver. My father was killed instantly, and my mother suffered numerous broken bones and internal injuries. The shards of glass from the shattered windshield left her face scabbed and scarred. When I was finally allowed to see her in the hospital, I fainted. I couldn't believe I was looking at my mother. Because my parents and the other driver didn't have insurance, and my mother was unable to work for some time, our family survived on welfare and food stamps. My three younger siblings and I experienced the pain and shame of poverty. I lived with a piercing sense of inferiority and embarrassment. Because I belonged to a lower socioeconomic class, I found it hard to look people in the eye. I was more inclined to bow to the upper class than shake their hands. Independence is a core value in Western culture, according to an article in the International Journal of Environmental Research and Public Health. People who need help to meet a basic need, such as food, are viewed as dependent, and dependency is humiliating. This is why Convoy of Hope makes it a priority to bolster the dignity of those we serve. I learned firsthand how poverty can erode self-worth. Some days we were forced to go to school without a lunch because the cupboards were empty. And on occasion, we had holes in our shoes and holes in our jeans, and this was before it was cool to have holy jeans. When we couldn't afford real haircuts, we trimmed our hair ourselves. In fact, we looked punk before there was such a thing. Despite those experiences, I wasn't overcome with bitterness at God because I also witnessed the power of kindness. Members of a local church brought groceries to our door, refurbished our home, and even put new shoes on our feet. One Sunday, a woman at church noticed I had holes in my sneakers and asked permission to take me to Kenny's shoe store. Back then, Kenny's offered three pairs of sneakers, one for $2.99, another for $3.99, and the nicest pair for $4.99. Times have certainly changed. When I walked into Kenny's, I naturally made a beeline to the shoes costing $2.99. That's all I had ever known. But that day, the woman waved me over to the shoes for $4.99. She said, "Hal, today, Jesus wants you to have the best they have." Even with such incredible kindness, my mother fought to cope with her new reality. She worked long hours to put food on the table, despite being paid far less than her male colleagues. The damage to her hip and ankle, which had been pinned back together after the accident, left her with a noticeable limp, and she was now raising four small children alone. But my mom refused to quit. She was strong, and so was her prayer life. Some nights I would hunker down outside her bedroom door and listen to her cry and pray herself to sleep. Her circumstances seemed so unfair and unjust. I couldn't understand how a loving God could allow my father to be taken from us, while the man who hit them walked out of jail 48 hours later. Meanwhile, our family was sentenced to a life of poverty. A myriad of questions raged inside me. I asked, "God, where are you? Don't you see what we're going through? Did you cause my dad to die? Did you allow him to die for a reason? Or did it just happen by chance?" Those unresolved questions haunted me for years and caused me to question God's care for me and His sovereignty in my life. Then, as a student at San Jose State University, I wandered into a church service one Sunday night. The pastor preached a message on God's plan and destiny for our lives based on Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." That night, God reassured me He was still behind the control panel of the universe and He had a plan for my life. I hated losing my father, and I didn't have many answers, but I concluded God was good, and I either had to trust Him or bail out on faith altogether. Either He was real, or I was on my own. There was no neutral space. I either had to follow Jesus or brand Him a fraud. Ultimately, the thought of living without Him and His help was too frightening. A universe absent of God didn't add up for me. I decided to go all in. And years later, God would take the tragedy in my life and use it to spark the work of Convoy of Hope. But that miracle began when I placed my fate and my future in His hands. Every step counts. I wish I could say all my questions vanished when I confirmed my faith in Jesus. If anything, it only summoned more questions. I also wish I could say all the trauma of my childhood was completely healed. The truth is, I still have scars. But my questions, wounds, and unpleasant memories are no longer holding me back. They no longer pose threats or create obstacles because God and I have an understanding. I'm going to take care of myself and endeavor to become more like Jesus and entrust my past and future to Him. That is the promise of 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. Cast all your anxiety on Him because He cares for you. You may have unresolved issues or deep disappointments that are preventing you from walking into the plans God has for you. Maybe you've suffered from a divorce, health crisis, or financial setback. Regardless, it is not His desire for you to be haunted by unpleasant memories. You do not have to be trapped by the pain of your past any longer. As you listen to What Really Matters, ask God to fill your soul with hope and vitality. Invite Him to reveal His path to wholeness and forgiveness. He wants to take this journey with you because the course is not clearly marked point A to point B. At times, you may trip and fall, but you can count on God to be there to pick you up, dust you off, and offer words of encouragement. As an adult, when my heart was aching with disappointment, I sank into periods of discouragement. The actions of others left me metaphorically bleeding out on the side of the road. Thankfully, I found healing and peace when I realized God the Father and His Son, Jesus, knew how I felt. God was betrayed by Satan, and Jesus was betrayed by Judas. They knew my struggle. So, whenever indignation and grief reared their ugly heads, I could find comfort and perspective by going to a fellow sufferer in prayer. Breaking free from the grasp of one's past and the grip of one's enemy is not as simple as 10 easy steps. You can think of this book as less self-help, which often focuses on an event, and more self-care, which is a lifestyle. There are actions you can take to improve your quality of life and draw closer to Jesus, but the road to wholeness begins with adjusting your expectations. Remember, you are embarking on an uncharted adventure to an unknown destination. En route, you can anticipate new discoveries and occasional disappointments. Some days won't feel perfect, but with each step you're closer to the life God has promised. Songwriter Stephanie Gritzinger puts this in perspective in her song, Oxygen. Baby steps and short breaths. Anything is progress. You can begin to breathe again with this simple prayer. Jesus, You know me better than I know myself. Help me understand what really matters to You, and help me discover ways to move beyond my pain and embrace the new beginning You have for me. 1. Deadly expectations. But a huge crowd from Galilee trailed after them, also from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, across the Jordan, and around Tyre and Sidon. Swarms of people who had heard the reports and had come to see for themselves. He told his disciples to get a boat ready so he wouldn't be trampled by the crowd. He had healed many people, and now everyone who had something wrong was pushing and shoving to get near and touch him. Mark chapter 3, verses 7 through 10, The Message Bible. The sun was especially bright for a November day in Missouri. Its rays were glinting off my computer screen, so I vaulted from my seat at my desk to adjust the blinds. Immediately, I felt a sharp pain below my shoulder blades, and I fell back into my chair. Years earlier, I had passed a kidney stone, and this felt similar, so I self-diagnosed that another boulder was attempting to enter my urinary canal. I drove myself home, dropped 2 Tylenol, and awaited my wife's return. An hour passed, with the pain increasing in intensity, and finally, Doree was home. "Doree," I said, "I think you better drive me to emergency. They'll give me some medicine to help pass the stone." 45 minutes later, I was sitting in a wheelchair with a blood pressure sleeve attached to my arm. When the nurse's face blanched, I knew this was more serious than a kidney stone. "What's happening?" I asked. "I don't think this is a kidney stone. It could be your heart," she replied. Seconds later, I was being hoisted onto a gurney and rushed down the hallway into surgery by an entourage of medical professionals. Even though death appeared to be knocking at my door and my blood pressure was skyrocketing, it was the calmest moment of my life. While doctors and nurses scurried to their stations, I whispered a prayer. No panic, just peace. "God, if this is the end of my journey, thank you for giving me a great life. I've been blessed. All I ask is that you take care of Doree and the girls." Those were my final words before the anesthesia kicked in and the physician commenced with the angiogram. When I awoke the next morning, Doree and my friend Mark Green were standing at the end of my bed. Mark had driven through the night to be by my side and pray for me. "Am I going to be okay?" I asked, seeking confirmation. "Yes, everything's good now," Doree said, leaning over the bed for a kiss. "You're going to be better than okay, my man," Mart added, taking hold of my hand. "God has more for you to do." Tears welled up in my eyes because, at that moment, I knew God was giving me another chance. Doree delivered the prognosis. "The doctor will be here shortly, but they had to put 2 stents in your left artery. But they said the rest of the heart looked fine, and you'll be okay." In the days that followed, as I lay in my hospital bed, I prayed for understanding and direction. I opened my Bible at random one night and began reading Psalm 138. My eyes fell on these words: "Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life." Psalm 138, verse 7. God hadn't called me to be a martyr, but I'd been living like one. I was working 2 jobs, speaking on weekends, and authoring books. It was obvious the demanding schedule and prolonged stress had contributed to my illness. It was time to make some serious changes, or there would be more stents in my future. I'm certain God tried to get my attention long before, I just wasn't listening. But now I was hearing Him loud and clear. If I didn't make changes and learn to deal with my stress was going to deal with me. In my attempt to live up to other people's expectations and accomplish more for God, I had maintained an unhealthy pace. Burnout is the result of misplaced priorities. Either you're running too fast or resting too little. I checked both boxes. Shortly after being released from the hospital, I resigned my position as editor-in-chief of a magazine, canceled 2 book contracts, cleared my speaking calendar, and stepped off the boards of several ministries. It was time to focus on my health and family and devote my full attention to the mission of Convoy of Hope. Regrettably, my pledge to make such life changes was short-lived. As my physical strength rebounded, so did my sense of obligation. Within months, I found myself traveling extensively and responding to new ministry opportunities. Meanwhile, for Doree and our daughters, it was like watching a bad television rerun. I resumed working 60-hour weeks, responding to nightly phone calls, and filling my calendar with appointments. In addition, I was giving the girls front-row seats to the perils of leadership. My youngest daughter, Hallie, said it best. "Sometimes leadership just isn't fun because people try to place unrealistic expectations on you." She nailed it. but most of the blame rested on my shoulders. I failed to respond appropriately to others' expectations, which manifested in undue stress. Of course, some pressure is necessary and beneficial. It can help motivate us to accomplish God's will. But an inner voice that incessantly demands we do more and more is not from God. In our quest to please Him, He never asks us to sacrifice ourselves and others. Someday, we don't want Jesus to hand us the deed to what we built and hear Him say, "This belongs to you. I had nothing to do with it." Great Expectations. Years earlier, I was honored to be appointed editor-in-chief of the magazine of the Assemblies of God Fellowship. Based in Springfield, Missouri, the denomination had grown to 85 million members worldwide. At one time, my grandfather served as one of the national leaders in the church.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.